Welcome to Slash Forward. In this episode, we're going to look at Richard Stanley's penultimate film, Dust Devil. Also ruined through studio involvement, lost to time, but later recovered and re-edited by Stanley himself. Let's get to it and see how it stacks up. We open on Orange and a man wearing a wool cap in a desert. He's pondering an ancient myth about a man who grew wings and flew like a bird, became a hunter and wandered this realm seeking prey and suffering the passions of men. And here he is, the Dust Devil. Who, what you listening for, buddy? Oh, he's hitching his way across the wastelands and finds a good Samaritan. He travels with her to the end of the road where he partakes in her hospitality, some of which is of the carnal variety. He consummates the relationship by breaking her neck and caressing her with his blade. Then, onto the traditional bowl-filling ceremony. We catch him later when he's showering down, indicating some sort of wild and gritty ritual, which is confirmed when he walks through the house the next morning. He sips his coffee, burns the house down for good measure, and drives off. We then transition to the Robinsons, seeing that they suck at both shaving and relationships. Wendy runs off, denying the accusations of adultery, while Mark gives her a hard time about fixing things, even though he just slapped the crap out of her. We then meet Sergeant Ben, getting the call on the arson with a possible homicide mixed in. Aw, but Ben's a sleepy man. When he arrives, they find evidence of the ritualistic killing, but very little of the remains remain. They also manage to find the car down the road a piece, but the Dust Devil is riding the rails now. He and Wendy are converging on the small town of Bethany. At the coroner's office, we learn that many aspects of the crime scene are consistent with witchcraft. Wendy ends up at a greasy spoon diner with Dusty, who finds his passions flaring, and he hitches his way down the road while she writes a Dear John letter to Mark. She then drives into the night, dreaming of black magic, until a figure in the road sends her into the ditch. In the morning, she surveys the damage and takes the best first step for survival, wandering aimlessly into the desert. But she does find an RV and a random shovel man who helps her get unstuck, and she thanks him, in her own way, and decides to keep this good karma going by picking up a sketchy hitcher. They enjoy some small talk, and he steals a small portion of her soul. Meanwhile, Ben heads out to Bethany to talk to his old friend Joe about the dark arts. Joe mostly answers his questions with riddles and myth. Compare this to Wendy talking about not believing in the supernatural, right before some ghost shenanigans go down. Then we switch back to Ben, where he finds some local officers torturing a material witness for information he surely would have given freely, a simple description of Wendy. Ben is then invited for a drink with the captain, who confirms his time on the case is limited because it's been escalated to a higher authority. The captain, contemplative of his own usefulness in this new era of lawmen, is considering packing up his family and moving on. That evening, we find Wendy pondering suicide, but the strange sense of a presence distracts her. When she goes to investigate, she finds nothing. The next morning, she wakes up refreshed and is surprised to find her passenger has returned. He explains away their strange experience as her falling asleep, and he presumes correctly that she's still willing to take him to the sea. Ben travels to the captain's house, where he's preparing to leave town for good. He managed to acquire some files on murders going way back that maybe help and he encourages Ben to continue his investigation. Meanwhile, Wendy and Dusty make it to the house of the Great Snake Father, and just thinking about that lithe, coiled body riles them all up, causing her to completely forget about faithful, abusive Mark, who's currently on his way to find her. But too late. Those mad harmonica skills warm her undercarriage. And, as Mark gets pushy with the locals about information regarding his wife, resulting in a brutal beating, Wendy receives her pleasures. Ben has revisited Joe, who takes him to a cave to explain his suspect is a shapeshifter, who seeks power from our world through murder, feeding off our light. He's trapped in our mortal realm until the ritual is complete. He then provides Ben with the binding stick, an artifact needed to strike down his foe and drive away his shadow. Back at the motel, Wendy looks for a light in Dusty's bag, coming across a bundle of Polaroids and an ornate box of fingers. He tries to reassure her by explaining he only did what his victims wanted of him, and then he offers to make a small incision to help her light leak out. She proves to be uncool with this and drives off, but he manages to take control of her car and calls a pileup, which he sets alight. Wendy just narrowly escapes into the open desert. We then briefly see Ben meeting up with Mark to establish that their mutual quests now align. The next morning, they find Wendy's breakup letter, indicating the hotness with which they appear to be on or around her trail. We see that she's currently wandering the desert, adorned with some makeshift shoes and her golden chones, closely pursued by the Dust Devil, and further pursued by Ben and Mark. Old Dusty creates a sandstorm to impede her progress and waylay Ben and Mark. Ben opts to save Mark from the horrors ahead with some tough love. And in the morning, Wendy arrives at a ghost town where she meets Ben. Ben crawls through a house, eventually emerging from a rear entrance, where he meets the Dust Devil and gets his intestines perforated. Confined by ritual, Dusty is forced to check his watch, allowing Wendy to get the drop on him, but her gun is unloaded. However, he's distracted by Ben's magic thingy, giving Wendy the time to upgrade her weapon situation and scatter his face to the wind. She then wanders off, leaving Mark affixed to the bumper, and apparently has become the spiritual successor to the Dust Devil, wandering the land and looking for fresh victims. And that was Dust Devil. The question now is, what happens when Richard Stanley gets to make a movie without studio interference? We'll find out on Friday. If you enjoyed the video, I'd love for you to become a part of the channel by subscribing. Thanks for watching.